Hi everyone, I'm Laura Hunott. Thank you for watching Rock On. Rock On is based on Jesus' words in Matthew 7:24, where he says, those that hear the word of God and apply it to their life are like those who built their house on the rock, and that rock is Jesus Christ. Rock On is an opportunity for people to come and share their journey to a personal relationship with Christ, and we're blessed to have in the studio today Pastor Sandy Whalen. Thanks for being here, Sandy.
Thank you for having me. I'm glad to be here.
Sandy, are you from Missouri? Or?
Yeah, I grew up in St. Louis in Afton, mm-hmm. Missouri, right in South County, mm-hmm. for many years.
And you grew up in an intact home, two-parent home?
I did. I had a two-parent home, and I had loving parents. I really did.
Yeah.
I had one brother and a sister, and my father and mother, they were both loving, but mm-hmm. my father turned out to be an alcoholic because he had worked at a local brewery. Mm-hmm. And so because of that, there was some violence in our house. And it wasn't against me or my sister or brother, that was a good thing, but right. against my mother.
Right.
So unfortunately, I saw a lot of violent things growing up against my mother.
Right, yeah, with the alcoholism, it would result in that. And did that result in divorce eventually in your family?
No, they stayed intact. And mm-hmm. eventually, my dad actually came to know the Lord and totally changed. Mm-hmm. But I grew up in it was a pretty dysfunctional family. But still, I did good in school. I went to Catholic school, Catholic grade school, high school, and I was very devoted Catholic. Mm-hmm. And then I met my future husband. I was only 16 when I met him. And, you know, at that age, you just think you know everything.
Right.
You know, and that he's going to be the one forever. Yeah. And I thought he was the one. I mean, he made me laugh. He was handsome. He thought I was pretty. And we got along well. And that's all I thought I needed in a husband, you know.
Right.
So we dated. And by 18 in high school, I was already engaged.
Wow.
Got married at 19. Had babies right away. And I'm thinking that as soon as we get married, well, now, because he was an alcoholic too, or had been drinking while and partying. I mean, I thought young kids always did it. I did that too as a teenager. But I thought once we got married that was all going to stop.
You know? Right.
I just assumed that he'd come home from work, we'd have a nice dinner, the kids would be playing, and everything's going to be perfect.
Right.
But as he drank more and more, the drinking didn't stop after we got married. Actually, it escalated.
Right.
And I was totally blown away. It's like, well, this isn't supposed to be happening. So I was confronting him. And of course, that led to arguments when he came home, just more and more arguments. And eventually that led, even within the first year, to physical abuse. And I was so shocked. And here, as we went through our marriage, just that escalated more and more and more. And here I am, just like my mother, being abused by my husband.
Right. It's not uncommon for us to gravitate to men that are like our fathers, even when it's dysfunctional like that. Somehow
right.
that worked. And so did you guys seek counseling? Was that something that eventually?
Actually, after about 8 years, I really loved my husband, and he loved me. We really did love each other. Mm-hmm. And I went to a counselor, but my husband wouldn't go. And so the counselor, who was a clinical psychologist and a priest, he was very good, but he said if he's not going to enter the counseling with me and he doesn't want to change, there's nothing I can do. And he actually said I should get a divorce. Mm-hmm. But I just rejected that. It's like, no, I want to work on this. I'll do whatever it takes. The thing is, we're good Catholics and we went to church every Sunday. But do you know, we never prayed once, never knew how to pray together. We never prayed together to heal our marriage, for God to intervene in our marriage. We just knew rote prayers and
right.
we didn't know how to pray.
Right.
And we never sought God. We sought counseling, but we didn't seek God.
Right, and until Christ is in you, we're ultimately Lord of our own lives, and without Him on the throne, and then in between you two to bring that. So so it was pretty frustrating, I imagine, heartbreaking.
It was, and we didn't want a divorce. So I continued in the marriage 6 more years, up to 14 years, but things just escalated. Mm-hmm. We drew further and further apart, though we still loved each other. Finally, in desperation, I gave an ultimatum. We did file for divorce, a no-fault divorce. We had a divorce, and I thought, oh, everything's going to be fine now. You know, I'm going to be happy. He's going to go his way. I'm going to go mine. However, when he went his way, all the money went his way, too. Right. And I was a single mother, divorced now with 2 boys, 10 and 13, and no way to really support them. I was working a full-time job. I think back then, this was in the early 80s, I was making, when we got divorced, $4.20 an hour. Raising 2 kids. And my support from him was very, very minimal from my ex-husband, was very little. So after about 3 months, everything was okay. I thought, oh, I'm free and, you know, everything's fine.
Yeah, not having the stress of the relationship for a while. Yeah.
Right. However, I could see my boys getting very upset and starting to act out in different ways. Mm-hmm. And I thought, well, I'll just try one of these singles groups. You know, I'll just see what life is all about. I haven't sowed my wild oats when I was young. I didn't really get a chance because I met my first husband when I was 16. So now it's time to go out and have some fun, right? And meet a wonderful person. And I really believed that I was going to find the man of my dreams right away. And within 2 years, not even longer than 2 years, I was going to get remarried to the man of my dreams. I really believed that. Mm-hmm. Again, I didn't pray. I didn't seek God. I went to church on Sundays, but I didn't seek the Lord. I didn't know how to pray.
Right. You just think that the problem is just another person, and that person's, you know, we don't get along, so let me just trade this one in for a different model.
Right.
And so you have no idea. If God created marriage, to consult Him about it, but we're just trying to make it work.
Right.
So, so what kind of took, which direction did your lifestyle go in at that point?
Well, I got into the single scene, and I met somebody, I met a few guys, and then I met somebody who said he loved me, and I hadn't heard those words for so many years, that somebody really loved me, and I truly believed him. Yeah. And we had a passionate love affair for 7 months, and I thought I was going to marry him. And in the meantime, I would run into his daughter that would tell me these different things about him. And as I had been dating him, I realized things didn't add up. You know, like 2 and 2 is 5, and he would just tell me different things, but then I would find out it wasn't true. And he told me he was a chronic liar, he was an alcoholic, and he was cheating behind my back. And I was just devastated. I broke up with him for just 30 days to get my head on straight. And I didn't pray. Again, I didn't pray because I didn't know how. Isn't that sad?
Right. You needed to go to church. You were just going through church, going to church, but you still really didn't know how to. I mean, you don't know how to ask, right?
I didn't know.
God has to reach out to us and waiting for you to get to a point of brokenness, I guess.
Yeah. So that's what happened. I finally broke up with him, but after that, I really went off the deep. And I went through man after relationship, multiple. I can't even tell you how many.
Right.
I ended up going to the bars, falling off the bar stools, thinking it was funny, or maybe bringing a guy home at night. And then he would leave in the morning, and I'd be left high and dry and just crying my eyes out.
Right.
And this was went on for 2 years, all the time, solid. And I know many people do that today. I mean, this is a common lifestyle.
Yeah.
Unfortunately, our world tells us that it's fine, that it brings happiness and joy, but it doesn't. It brings heartbreak and misery.
To the point of feeling suicidal?
That's exactly what happened. Finally, my last lover, after our last affair, he told me that now he was remarrying his ex-wife. Mm-hmm. And that was just the I couldn't take it anymore. But in the meantime, my friends have been dragging me to a Bible study. And I'm going, I'm not going to a Bible study. I'm the sinner. I'm the group. Why would I want to go to a Bible study? But, you know, I valued their friendship. And I didn't want to lose their friendship. And I thought, I'm just going to be with my friends. And I would go make fun of the speaker, make fun of what they would say. And we'd go out to the bars drinking after the Bible study. But the Word of God does not return void. Mm-hmm. And God's Word was somehow, because I was so hurting by now, I knew my life was wrong. I knew I was taking a wrong turn. I didn't know how to change it. And I could feel the Holy Spirit, when I would go to these Bible studies, talking to me and speaking in my heart. And I would say, what is that? What's going on? I feel something. I had never felt God before, ever, never. So I continued going to these Bible studies, and they were telling me how to get saved, how to know Jesus personally. And I say, oh, I'm a good person. I do good works. I'm going to get to heaven.
I go to church.
Yeah, I go to church. Yeah.
I know Jesus.
Yeah. Well, I didn't say that because I really didn't know Jesus.
Right.
But I think my girlfriend pounded into my head Ephesians 2:8-9, that you're saved by grace through faith, not of your own works, unless you boast about it. Mm-hmm. And I said, oh, no, I'm saved by my own works. I'm going to heaven because I'm a good person. Mm-hmm. And she said, no, Sandy, no. It's all by God's grace and through faith and having Jesus your Lord and Savior. And I battled with that. I read it in the Word. And finally, one day, it was starting to make sense, but I still didn't want to believe it. Mm-hmm. So here I am after this guy breaks up with me again, and I'm just at the end of it. And I had heard all these wonderful things about Jesus and that he could save me and transform my life. But the devil was on the other shoulder. My children were gone. It was late at night, and I had just broken up with this guy, and I just was wanting to end my life. I just didn't want to go on. The devil was on this shoulder just telling me, end your life, go get some sleeping pills. It's simple, it's easy, and just take your life. What do you have to live for? And to be honest, at that point, I didn't have much to live for, just my children. I was very unhappy in my job, and I didn't want to go on. But I was on the point of, what do I do? What do I do? And I could hear Jesus on this side and the Holy Spirit on this side saying, come to me. I am the way, the truth, and the life, and I will give you life. I will save you. And then the devil was on this side saying, just end your life. And I just was perplexed. But I didn't really want to die. I wanted to live and wanted to be a good mother for my children. And I wanted to change. But I had no clue how to change. I had no clue how Jesus could change me. Mm-hmm. And so I just didn't know what to do. I got down on my knees and cried out. I said, Jesus, if you're real, come change my life. Mm-hmm. I don't know if you're even real, but if you are, I just come to you a mess and just change my life.
Mm-hmm. Uh-huh. And I want you to come back to Rock On and find out what happened if Christ changed Sandy's life. Thank you.
The cornerstone for the New Life Evangelistic Center at 1411 Locust Street in St. Louis reads, for there's no other foundation than that which is laid, which is Jesus Christ. 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 11. This cornerstone for this historical building, which was laid in 1911 by President Taft, the governor of the state of Missouri, and the mayor of the city of St. Louis, is the theme for NLEC's extensive work among the many hurting and homeless people around the world. New Life Evangelistic Center is a very unique homeless veterans program to help homeless veterans be set free from the cycle of homelessness on the streets. It's reaching out among the homeless women and children. And its renewable energy program is now going around the world through a very special Light Up the World Fund. Why don't you get directly involved in the work of New Life Evangelistic Center? For further information, go to www.newlifeevangelisticcenter.org. You can also give through the PayPal system at that area. Remember, there's no other foundation that which is laid, which is Jesus Christ. New Life Evangelistic Center believes it and is doing it.
KNLC Channel 24 is seeking qualified sales reps now. Become a member of our PASS program. PASS, participating actively in service and sales. Do you have experience in sales? Do you have a good work ethic? Are you creative? Do you stand out from the crowd? Do you desire to serve God to help the homeless and the needy? Then we want to talk with you. Call today. We're hiring.
Are you interested in learning more about renewable energy, how you can use wind power, solar power, biomass, biodiesel, and much more? Then you need to go to the More Energy website. And you can go to that by going to www.moreenergy.org. Yes, go to the More Energy website and discover how you can get more energy and be set free from the grid and the high utility bills.
Welcome back to Rock On. If you're just joining me, I'm Laura Hunott, and I'm here with Reverend Sandy Whalen. Sandy has been here sharing her testimony to a personal relationship with Christ. And if you were watching, she was just leaving off of how the Lord was really drawing her. She grew up in an intact home with a father who eventually, you know, alcoholism really took hold in her family. And, you know, there was violence towards her mom. So it was a pretty tumultuous experience, a loving home, but that progression. Thankfully, eventually, her father actually came to Christ in his 80s, and she saw a complete transformation in his life. And she's the middle child of three. Grew up, you know, going to Catholic school, Catholic church, you know, got married at a very young age, had children 16, 18 years old, you know, just thought, you know, hey, you get married and you live happily ever after. And unfortunately, her husband, you know, was drinking as well, and it progressed into alcoholism as well. After 14 years of her trying to stay determined and committed in the marriage, they wound up divorcing as well. Sandy found herself being a single mom of two young preteen boys, teenage boys. You know, it was the 80s, going out to the clubs, meeting men, thinking I'll meet someone else within 2 years. That led to, you know, partying and promiscuity, trying relationships and the failing. You know, what happens for a lot of women sometimes, and felt the brokenness of that. Fortunately, she had a couple of girlfriends that were encouraging her to come to a Bible study and telling her about Jesus. Now, the whole time, she's going to church, but she did not know how to pray. She didn't know how to ask God into her marriage, into her life. And so you're going to the Bible studies, but you're struggling back and forth still with your lifestyle and what you're doing. But the Holy Spirit is really working on your heart. And you also said the devil was pulling on you too, because you were really at the point of suicide and depression. And so can you pick us up from there?
Yeah, so there I was. The devil's on one side, but the Holy Spirit's on the other side. And Jesus saying, come to me, come to me, and you'll have a whole new life. And the devil saying, just end it, just end it. And I'm on my living room floor crying and then crying out to Jesus, saying, Jesus, I don't even know if you're real, but if you are, come and change my life. Here I go to church all my life, but I didn't even know if he was real. But I said, Lord, I'm going to give you a shot. I don't have nothing to lose. And I want a whole new life. I don't know how it's going to happen. I don't know anything. I did not know one scripture, not one scripture at that time.
I mean, you mentioned Ephesians, though. That was significant to you.
You're right. I guess I didn't know that one.
Well, in coming to faith, which was really significant to understand, it wasn't by works. It was by what Christ had done, by grace through faith alone.
Right. I think all my life, I thought I was going to heaven by my good works.
Yes.
So this was so radically different.
I think most of us do. We don't understand what Christ has done for us.
Right.
Yeah, and that you have to receive him. But you had to come to a point of brokenness to really get that.
That's what I was just going to say. I was just broken on my living room floor.
Yeah.
Cried and cried and cried. And I felt like I was transformed that very moment, though I was spiritually, I know. But I know by the next morning, everything felt different. All that weight, all that burden, all the shame.
All the suicidal thoughts.
Oh, yeah, they left instantly. They left that night because I would have just ended it that night. I mean, it was very strong. It wasn't just a little temptation. It was a strong temptation.
Yes.
And I know many people today are tempted with that.
Yes.
But it's from the pit of hell. It's from the devil himself.
Absolutely. Suicide is always from the devil.
Yeah. And I am so glad I answered Jesus and said, Lord, whatever, just save me. Just save me. If you're real, come and change my life. And within days, I started sharing the gospel. I hardly knew anything, but I just would tell everybody what Jesus did for me. And I start witnessing and going to Bible studies, going to different churches, hearing the word of God fresh and new for the very first time. However, I still had this addiction of sex in my life. And I still thought a man was going to make me happy. But as I went through the first year and a half, I realized that these men weren't making me happy. And they weren't going to serve the Lord. Mm-hmm. They wanted to just get what they could from me.
Right.
And then here I am trying to serve the Lord and still have this boyfriend here or this relationship over there, off and on. It slowed down a whole lot. But still, because it was such a heavy addiction for 2 years, that I didn't stop going to the bars right away.
Right. Follow me and I'll change you. But it's a process.
It was a process. I can't say, I mean, I was instantly changed spiritually, but physically my flesh was holding on to the old life.
You think that's where you're going to meet love and God. Mm-hmm. It's a battle. The Lord wants to transform us by the renewing of our mind and in the process of following him and taking us out of the world and learn his ways. Yeah. So that went on about a year before.
A year and a half. And I finally realized one day, well, it must have been the Lord, of course, saying to me, who are you going to serve? Are you going to give me your heart wholeheartedly or just go serve the devil? Take your picks. Who are you going to serve? And finally, I just had to make a decision. You know, I've had enough of the old life. It only brings heartache and sorrow and pain and then shame. And then, of course, whenever I would sin, though, I always would ask for forgiveness. And I know God is faithful and just, and he would always forgive me. But I just didn't want to keep doing that over and over and over and over for years and trying to satisfy my flesh. So finally, after about a year and a half, I said, I'm done with that. That's it. And I'm going to serve you, God, with all my heart. And then the Holy Spirit just filled me up even more. And I just got more on fire for the Lord. In fact, I started going on mission trips. And I didn't even know what a mission trip was. I think I went on my first one. I was about 1987 to Jamaica. And I just gave God like a 1 week trial. I said, Lord, it's a 1 week trip. I want to see if you're calling me to missions. I have no idea. You know, I don't know what's going to happen. It transformed my life upside down. When I got back, I just wanted to go back to Jamaica. I just wanted to be overseas all my life, all the time. That's all I wanted to do. However, my young son was still at home, and he had to go through college and, you know, and grow up a little bit. And I wanted to go right then. I said, Lord, okay, I'll sell everything and go right now. And God said, no, you stay home and wait till your son's at least a sophomore in college. Mm-hmm. So I did, and with very reluctantly, but I stayed home and was a good mother to my son. Mm-hmm. And became very involved in church and outreach and singles outreach and all kinds of things. And in 1990, I actually joined a mission group then called Youth with a Mission. Mm-hmm. I went for training in Arkansas for 1 year. And then God called me to Calcutta, India, of all places, where Mother Teresa was. I worked with Mother Teresa in her homes and worked in the ghettos. Well, the ghettos, they don't call them ghettos there. They call them bustees, mm-hmm. or the poorest of the poor worked. Right. And I worked where Mother Teresa worked, too, mm-hmm. and with the homeless, the poor, the needy, started children's programs. And it's really funny because God calls us sometimes to things we don't think we can do.
Right.
And I ended up starting children's programs. I never was a children's minister in my life, but because I played the guitar, the kids just followed me with the guitar. I learned songs in their language. And so, man, they wanted to sing the songs. So before long in Calcutta, here I was starting these children's programs all over Calcutta, which really surprised me. and then I was there for life, I thought. But after 2 years, God called me back to the United States, and he told me to go to Bible school, which I was totally shocked because I had a lot of training in my Youth with a Mission organization. But he called me to Bible school in Rochester, New York, which was Elam Bible Institute. Mm-hmm. And I went there for 3 years and thinking after I graduate, okay, I'm going to Africa. I'm going back overseas now because I love being overseas. It was such an honor. It was one of the hardest things I ever did, I got to say. Being in Calcutta was one of the very hardest, but one of the best, too.
Yeah.
When you serve the Lord with all your heart, you make those sacrifices, the joy that you get back is uncomparable to just living a, you know, so-so life.
Yes.
I never wanted to live a so-so life, just get by life, never. And God help me, I never will.
Amen.
By his grace.
Amen.
So I went to Bible school, graduated after 3 years, and Elam, the Bible school, had a building in downtown Rochester called the Rochester Urban Center that they wanted to use for the homeless. And God spoke to me really clearly after graduation, not to go to Africa, but to start this homeless mission that they already owned the building and everything that could live there, and just start from scratch, this homeless mission. And I was like, oh God, no, I'm going overseas. There's no way. But he even gave me a vision about it. And I knew that that was God's will.
Mm-hmm.
So after a lot of back and forth with the Lord, I said, Lord, I surrender. So myself and another lady that graduated with me in 1997, we started the mm-hmm. Rochester Urban Center. It was an outreach to the homeless, a big soup kitchen. We had services or food giveaways, Bible studies, lunch programs, about 6 days a week. And I mean, we started with nothing. We started with a hot dog. And mm-hmm. to see God just provide everything. We didn't have nothing. And all these years too, since I've been saved now 17 years, I was praying for a wonderful man of God to come along. And I prayed almost every day about it, but it wasn't like my God. It wasn't like it had to happen. But even one time I got frustrated and I said, God, I'm not going to pray about this anymore. I just give up. I felt the Lord said, no, 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 keep praying. But the unusual thing was I wasn't just praying for any man. I was praying to marry an ex-con. And most people will ask me, why would I want to marry an ex-con? Well, go back many years to when I was saved, 17 years before, I was on the bench of a seat in a church, a Life Christian Center, actually, and they had these ex-cons always coming in, sharing their testimonies of what God had done in their lives with the guns and the drugs and how God had delivered them. And I was like, man, I want to marry a guy like that, not because I want a bad boy, but I want a man with a great testimony that we can share the Word of God in our lives and his testimony all over the world.
All right.
And so that's why I prayed for that.
Awesome. Well, I want you to come back to Rock On, and I want to thank those of you that support the work here at New Life Evangelistic Center and find out if Sandy got her answered prayer. Thank you.
Can you think about how valuable personal hygiene items are when you're homeless. You don't have a toothbrush, you don't have a razor, shaving cream, deodorant, soap. By you gathering up these items and putting them in the gallon plastic bag, getting the whole family involved and bringing them to the New Life Evangelistic Center, you're helping the homeless to break the cycle of homelessness and be able to go out and apply for jobs and clean up and feel good about themselves. Will you please let Christ's love flow through you and bring those personal hygiene items to the New Life Evangelistic Center at 1411 Locust Street in St. Louis.
A challenge exists today for the modern church. That challenge is to let the Holy Spirit lead in new and exciting ways on just how to take the good news that Christ has risen to a modern world still in need of His abundant grace and forgiveness. KNLC is looking for sales representatives to aid these churches in bringing a 2,000-year-old message of miracles using the technology of the new millennium. Join our sales team and become a member of PASS today. PASS, participating actively in service and sales.
Definitely a blessing to be able to have an opportunity such as this one to work for KNLC TV, Channel 24, doing something that I love and reaching out and helping others.
Call us today at 314-881-3220 and change your life and the lives of others.
Welcome back to the latter few minutes of Rock On. Reverend Sandy Whalen was just leaving off how God finally answered a prayer after 17 years when she was ready to give up. Yeah. Sandy, in this short amount of time, share with us about that answered prayer.
Well, He was everything I had put on a list. I believe in prayer lists and being very specific with God. Mm-hmm. The number one thing was that He'd be a man of God and on fire for the Lord, mm-hmm. which He was. I had 10 things on that list, and every single thing God answered, every single one. And then when we started dating and getting romantically involved, I got really scared. I was like, oh my gosh, He can't be the one, it's not time. You know what I did? I made a second list. And I put impossible things on it. Like, Lord, He can't see right to drive. He only had straight vision. He had lost His peripheral vision. So I said, Lord, I don't want to drive a car the rest of my life and have to drive Him all around. So if He's going to be the man for me, let Him be able to drive, and you need to heal his eyes. Long story short, I was driving him home from the Rochester Urban Center, this mission one night. I said, Pat, let's just believe God for a miracle. I slapped my hands over on his eyes. As I was, had my other hand on the steering wheel. I said, in the name of Jesus, eyes be opened up. And I took my hands down, and he could see perfectly. And after all those things, I knew that he was the one. And so within 9 months, well, we had a whirlwind romance. It was just over the top. We got married, and we were happily married. We had a giant marriage in the city of Rochester on Lake Ontario, invited the whole city, all the homeless. We had 500 people at our wedding. We were on 3 news stations at the time. It was wild and crazy. And we had a wild and wonderful, blessed first year. And then he started getting pain in his hip, and he was diagnosed shortly thereafter with bone marrow cancer. We were devastated. Here we are serving the Lord, working at the Rochester Urban Center, and he's diagnosed with cancer, and he has a year and a half or so to live. But I gotta say, through all that time, we never got so strong in our faith as we did then. We stormed heaven. We believed God for miracle after miracle after miracle, and we saw miracle after miracle after miracle.
And you know what? Sandy's probably gonna come back sometime and share more of a testimony of her husband through her book. Sandy, because of the sake of time, can you tell me the name of your book, where people can get it, and what you're doing now. You have an outreach
yes.
in St. Louis. And then we're going to come back and talk a little more deeply on another program.
Okay. Well, the name of my book is Caught by an Ex-Con, because that's what I was. Caught by an Ex-Con by Sandy Whalen. Mm-hmm. And you can get it on my email there, at Amazon.com, of course, or BarnesandNoble.com, mm-hmm. or Get Saved Today at Yahoo.com. It's on the screen.
Okay. And tell us a little bit about, fast forward, to the outreach here in St. Louis now that you're doing.
Well, after my husband died, after 5 years of marriage, I started an outreach to women that are widowed, divorced, separated, called Women of Restored Destinies. Mm-hmm. Then I moved back to St. Louis 4 years ago, and now I have a woman support group here, Women of Restored Destinies, as well as a large outreach ministry to the homeless.
Okay, and give us your email address real quick.
GetSavedToday@Yahoo.com.
Sandy, thank you for being here and sharing your testimony.
Thank you so much.
Thank you for watching Rock On. God bless you.